Councils of the Faith, the Dadestan Denig of Zoroastrianism. Edited by Alan Lewis Silva. Podcast 5. Chapter 44. As to the 43rd question and reply, that which you ask is thus: there is a man who is superintending and skillful, in whom great skill as regards religion is provided, and the high priest's duty and officiating priest's duty are performed by him, or they are not performed by him, but in him great skill as regards religion is provided. In a place of that district there is no one who rightly knows the commentary and the proper and improper, so that he comes forth into a place of such decay, and the people of the district, who constantly order all the religious rites of many sacred ceremonies from any poor man of the various persons from other districts whose skill and superintending are not like his, but they constantly come to that district, shall constantly receive from him all the many religious rites and many sacred ceremonies. And that man, who is revered and skillful, proceeds not undejectedly and bashfully to his own superintending position, the position of the religion and position of the skill which are his, he does not demand any employment in the district or any award from the district, and does not know how to provide any other employment or award, in which there would be any fitness for him. Are the people of the district, on account of the skill and activity which that man has exercised in religion, due to the performance of all the religious rites and sacred ceremonies which they constantly order, thereupon to prepare that man a stipend, and is it necessary for them to give a stipend to that man, or how is it necessary to act, and is it necessary for them to collect it for him, or not? And of the much advantage of all the religious rites and work is it necessary to speak thus? Until the time that thou hadst come it was not possible for us to order except of him who is inferior to thee, or how is it to be done? Is it necessary to collect a stipend for him on account of the benefit and reasoning thought on other subjects, of which he was the means, or how is it necessary for the superintendent of our people to collect such stipend of skill, position, and religion? The reply is this, that a man of such description as written above, and superintending the exercise of skill and provision of ability, is very worthy of a stipend and courtesy, also, through good management of all religious rites and the ceremony of the sacred beings, he is very confident in any uncertainty. Therefore it is necessary to consider that he manages more openly and better than those whose skill and ability are not like his, and also as regards stipend and reasoning thought, owing to the worthiness of the ceremony of the sacred beings, his are more whose skill, ability, and activity in religion are greater. And as to a man who is as written above, when all those religious rites and ceremonies are well managed by him, and his repeated direction and right continuance of proper duties are an accumulation of his own reasoning thought and great capability, and are ordered of him with great solicitude, one is also to consider him a stipendiary thereby, and a thriving acquirement of ample reasoning thought. And as to him, moreover, who is less skilled than he, and of inferior position, by as much as he is not so worthy, his custom is therefore to produce a want of himself again. But he who has much skill should have a great stipend, and he of medium ability should have a medium one, he having less means of benefiting worthily, maturely, and necessarily. And the value is as it is said in Revelation thus, the stipend they should announce to him who is an upholder of religion is 2 shares, and to him who is mediocre only 1. To him whose lot is inferior. That man is a master and high priest whose usage also is wise, and in ability, goodness, and skill is the best of those of the religion of the Mazda worshippers, which is the religion of wise upholders. And the exercise of his religious disposition, originally possessing a religious stipend, which they shall order of him in that place, and that of the other worthy ones and applicants in the place and coming applying to the place, as much as it is worth and happens to be their own want, one is to altogether thoroughly well consider for him. Good destiny is not fulfilled by granting to those applying, but through forward ability, the forward, kind-hearted, and extreme skill provided, and grand position he is worthy of much stipend, and it is important to make them stipendiary in their own gradation of applying. For the observance of moderation and the granting of applications are mutually destructive, and it is discriminatively said that the high priest Jamisp of the Hvovaz considered, in that mode, the much skill of that good superintendent being without a stipend as not disproportionate, but most justly very moderate. Moreover, to collect for all except for 1 skillful man, and to provide a stipend for any other applicants, is not right, and the limits should be moderate, for each one really shares the moderate apportionments according to his own want, apart even from the sacred ceremony. But to collect for such a man, who has kind-heartedly superintended by rule during reasoning thought, is a greater good work than to approve even him who is superintending much more authoritatively. And he who has himself requested is to obtain everything last, for, except in that case when a virtuous doer has in any mode begged a livelihood and is not capable of earning it, so that something even of the righteous gifts of clothing is begged by him, to live in idleness is not the way to be assisted, but he who has not himself requested, and is wise, is to beg a suit of clothes. They give to the good provider of gifts much praise, and for the preservation of the perfect giver are many religious friends, and the position of the upholders of religion, so it is necessary to give, and to consider it as provided for the great female whom Revelation greatly celebrates, that all source connected with religion, as it is said that in the opinion of human, the high priest, the propitious religion is, as it were, the way of saving their souls. About upholders of religion, and a more particular rule how the lawful computation should be for glorifying with moderation, a chief of the priests has spoken thus, "Shouldst thou be our father in wealthiness, I am thy protector in body and thou becomest thy protector in soul." The same collection is the way of the friends of religion for begging from the upholders of religion the preservation of the soul, and for well considering, extremely gracefully and fully reverently, the advantage and pleasure of the position of the upholders of religion, so that they shall properly collect for the preservation of souls by the mode of going to collect thoroughly with great gain. Chapter 45. The 44th question is that which you ask thus, of priesthood or discipleship which is the priest's duty, and which the disciples, which is that which it is necessary to have in priesthood, and which in discipleship. The reply is this, that the priesthood and discipleship are connected together, the priests teach the scriptures, and the disciples learn the knowledge of the religion, that is, the Avesta and Zend. The priest, have been disciples, through the teaching of his own priest they make the aroused existence of even a disciple become a priest, and in one body with the learner are the priesthood and discipleship. Through that which he has learned as a disciple from the priest he is wiser, and owing to the priesthood in his own person he teaches the disciple who is a learner, the desire which is his craving for learning is also owing to that in his own priest, when he was a disciple unto his own priest. And the disciple and priest are even such as is said thus, the director of the profession of priests of Pars, and chieftain over the faithful and the officiating priests of Pars, is the leader of the religion, and his disciple is a disciple in a selected foremost position among the priests of the religion, set up over those acquainted with the commentary. The more infallible of these is the powerful skill of the priest put forth through the ritual and visperid, and his skill in the commentary, the skill of disciples in the Avesta is, further, fully understood, and sin recognized as oppressive, through the narangs of the sacred ceremony, ablution and non-ablution, purity and pollution. And both professions are the indispensable preservers of great decisions as to that which the priestly disposition has taught, done, and considered about the perpetual existence of every being, the complete goodness and final success of the non-existent evil and entire good of the sacred beings, the annihilation of the demons, and the complete understanding of the friends of the sacred beings. Chapter 46. The 45th question is that which you ask thus, is it allowable that those of the priesthood, when there is no daily livelihood for them from the life of the priesthood, should abandon the priesthood, and that other work be done, or not? The reply is this, that there is no loss of reputation to priests from priestly duties, which are themselves the acquired knowledge that is accumulated by the priestly disposition, care for the soul, and the requisite good works. And there is this advantage, that, through acquaintance with the religion of the sacred beings, and certainty as to the reward of the spirit, they make them become more contented in adversity, more intelligent as regards stability of character in difficulty and restriction, and more through knowledge the abode of hope for those saved. So that it is not fit they should abandon the priesthood, which is both harmless and an employment with advantages that has required much trouble to learn. But, indeed, when they do not obtain a daily livelihood from priestly duty, and the good do not give them chosen righteous gifts for it, and they do not let them obtain any from next of kin or the wicked even by begging, a livelihood may be requested from the paid performance of ceremonies, management of all religious rites, and other priestly disciples' duty therein. When even by that they do not obtain it, they are to seek a livelihood by agriculture, sheep-rearing, penmanship, or other proper employment among priests, or when it is not possible for them to live even by these, they are to seek it by bearing arms, hunting, or other proper employment in the profession of a virtuous warrior. And when even it is not possible for them to maintain their own bodies, which are in requisite control, by that which is cravingly digested, they are to beg a righteous gift authorizedly as an effectual remedy, by living idly, or not expending strength, their own bodies, which are in control, are without livelihood, but not authorizedly. Chapter 47. As to the 46th question and reply, that which you ask is thus: at a sacred feast of those of the good religion, in which there are 50 or 100 men, more or less, just as it happens, and 7 men who are engaged in the performance of the religious rite which is celebrated by them are feasting together with them, of those 7 men there are some who are easily able to pray 5 sections, and some 6 subdivisions, of the Avesta, but no chapter of the commentary is easy to them, and all 7 of them are disputing about the right to the foremost places. And he to whom 30 chapters in the commentary are easy speaks thus: the foremost place is mine, and it became my place owing to great retentiveness of memory, for I know the commentary well and the proper and improper, and my place must be good, for whenever I do not indicate this as the place of religion unto the people I am not in the security of religion, but you should not dispute about my place, for it is not becoming to dispute it, because this neglect and outlandishness, which someone brings constantly into the religion, is not due to me. Those 7 men, moreover, speak constantly unto him thus: our place is more important and must ever be so, for every man of us is able to pray several sections in his own officiating priestly duty, and it is ever necessary to consider who is more participating in sharing a reward. Then as to those whose Avesta is very easy, or him who knows the commentary and the proper and improper well, and their goodness and greatness, as asked by us in this chapter, direct someone to make them clear unto us, for when he demonstrates the littleness and greatness in this subject his great religion is then completely an advantage. The reply is this: that, as to that which you ask me to write, so that they may decide whether 30 chapters in the commentary are easier, or really the other, be they 5 or be they 6 sections of the Avesta, are easier, there is no deciding, because which are the chapters and which the sections. For, as regards more cleverness and less cleverness, it is not clear, there are some of the sections greater than many sections, and there are chapters as great as many chapters, but to understand severally the divisions and enumeration of him to whom 5 sections of the Avesta are easy, and also of him whose 30 chapters in the commentary are easy, it is necessary for making the calculation to consider every single division in the commentary as equivalent to 7 equal divisions apart from the commentary. And it is thereby thus manifest who has skill in the one and who has skill in the other, and whoever has less, when there is nothing in it regarding which he is otherwise than when the superintending command of rulers delivered over to him the place of duty, or on account of a new officiating priestly duty or directorship of the season festivals, or the foremost places being occupied, or like causes he becomes otherwise, is fit for all the great share and very good estimation of the place of one much more skillful, when their being fitting and skillful, or their excess or deficiency, is not specially manifest from their skill. And him to whom the commentary is very easy, having prayed much, it has seemed important to consider more thriving proportionable to his eating. And great and ample respect for both their ways of worthiness is an advantage and fully necessary, skill in the commentary and that in the Avesta being together mutually assisting, for even the solemnizers of the Avesta have need for information from the commentary about the scattered proper and improper usages of the sacred ceremony. The more efficient information from the commentary is advantageous when the ceremonial is proceeded with by them, and one of those 2 is one of the skillful, and a friend, provider, glorifier, and aggrandizer for the other, and the friends of religion are good friends and, therefore, also providers of fame for both of them. When, too, they are publishing accusing statements, one about the other, from necessity, or from the violence which is owing to the adversary, it is important to become an excuser as regards them, and not a diminisher of their share, nor a bringer of unhealthiness to their united strength. Chapter 48. The 47th question is that which you ask thus: how is a liking for the desirableness, joy, and pleasure arising from the sacred ceremony friendly to Ahura Mazda, the Amisha Spenta, and the guardian spirits of the righteous? In what manner is the perfection of him by whom the ceremony is ordered and the people of the country then exalted by them, and how and in what manner does it become the vexation, defeat, anguish, and discomfort of the evil spirit, the demons, and the fiends? How is the purpose of the ceremony? What is the ceremony? Where is the place when they shall perform it? What is good when they shall perform it? And how is it good when they shall perform it? The reply is this: that the great satisfaction of Ahura Mazda and the Amisha Spenta arising from the sacred ceremony is in the purity of its formulary, and also in this, that it is completely fulfilling his own blessed commands, because he ordered that entire goodness for the complete procedure of those of the good religion, as the recompense and full allotment of the sure upholder of religion among those who rightly recite it. From the performance of the ceremonial of the sacred beings are the propitiation of the good spirits, the destruction of violence, the increase of digestiveness, the growth of plants, the prosperity of the world, and also the proper progress of living beings, even until the movement of the renovation of the universe and the immortality of the creatures arise therefrom. It became so, it is expressly said, because the sacred beings are great, and unitedly opposing it the demons are particularly undesirous of it, and owing to it their defeat and vexation are severe, its consecrated cup also becomes the express preservation of the ceremony. And its purpose inquired about is this: that religion is transmitted clearly to the intelligent, that is, it is not the wisdom whose comprehension exists in worldly beings, and as, moreover, even that which is not understood by worldly wisdom is really the creature of the spirits, that also which is the spiritual formulary is for making it intelligible to worldly beings through the body. That religion which is comprehensible by the world and authoritative is rightly connected with that which worldly beings are quite able to understand through worldly wisdom, and the understanding about its evidence as to that which is spiritual and powerful, apart from the worldly evidence of superiors, is the right way of the intelligent. That proper purpose, in which, moreover, the ceremonial, owing to timely memory for its own completion, is unique, is this unique exhibition of purity in the pure glorifying of the heavenly angels, as is commanded, just as the purpose of the ceremonial of a season festival being before the season festival, and of maintaining the exposure of the body of a jackal or a man, is to make the body clean from the corrupting pollution, and also from outward contamination. That also which might be written, as to the much retribution appointed as regards washing the limbs outside with clean moisture from clean animals and plants, and then completely washing the body with the purifying water streaming forth, as to the clean scents among those which they rightly perceive, and making the body and clothing sweet scented, and as to the putting on of the white and proper garment of Vohuman, and supposing the power of avarice to be the site of distress, is all superfluous. But it is needful still as regards these matters, that is, while engaged in the ceremonial it is not to be hurried owing to any hunger or thirst, owing to liability of punishment for religious practices, or even owing to deficiency of vacant space. And before the ceremonial one is to eat at the appropriate time, and such food, too, as is preparable and only moderately troublesome, and any of that which one has to perform aloud in leaving the heavenly-minded, yet moderate, duty in the abode of fires, which is perpetual light is proper, pertaining to good works, and good for him, and thereby lodging in him. And they, that is, the gloomy ones, thereby see the service for them themselves is short, and good are they who come into the world glorified by praise. The position of the ceremony holders themselves, that is, the position of the officiating priest and his co-operators, is the orv's place, and, if it be the precinct of prayers, one should wash it over with the water of purification, to make it clean. The apparatus of the ceremonial, together with its own man, who is a solemnizer, and the two creatures which are solid out of these four, fire, metal, water, and plants, just as one has to bring them together in readiness, the stone orves, the stone and mortar con, and the hum mortar, cups, and crescent-shaped stands set upon it, are all ceremoniously washed with the water of purification. The bright fire on the clean fire stand is increased by the dry firewood delivered to it purified, and one is to put upon it at appropriate times the wholesome perfumes of various kinds of plants, and the water of purification, which is ritualistically produced by reciting the words of revelation, is in the clean metal cups. The well-grown Ham through which the world is possessed of creatures, the Ham through which the production of Zarathustra occurred, is a symbol of the white Gokarano as regards the immortality of the renovation of the universe manifest therefrom, and the resting places of its vengeance are the various demons, and with it one is to put attentively in its appropriate place the pomegranate plant of the Orvaram. The vegetable sacred twigs carefully girded with the vegetable belt and girdle, and the metallic crescent-shaped stands, which are in the position of those who are sovereigns of the worldly creatures who are interpreted as the sacred twigs of the treatises, are prepared. When arranged by the bringing together of clean worldly productions, so much the more purely as is possible, the arrival of the pure renders all the symbols reliable. Those celebrators of whom the outside of their own bodies is defiled with their bodily refuse and in clean clothing, and their disposition, if in the religion of moderate eating in which is a thirst for lawfully drinking, is customarily sleep and lethargy through the tendency to falsehood of their wisdom, are to consider, even from their innermost hearts and minds, the retribution of the body of wrath, the falsehood and bad thoughts in that disposition of infamy, and the recompense of their own renunciation of it, they are to atone for their sinfulness, and to seek great purification of mind. And having acquired eyes speaking forth, hands in a state of ablution, and every other member of the body, especially therewhere well accomplishable, free from its bodily refuse and covered with the clean clothing, the tongue is preserved and guarded from falsehood and the hand from sin, the mind is established by little preparation with good consideration for knowledge of the sacred beings, and even the good are to recite by direction the verbal renunciation of sin. The officiating priest, having directed and purified the place of the fire with liturgical words, is to go and walk unto the place of the officiating priests while glorifying the sacred beings, and to consider invocable the glory given to the luminaries and the guardian spirits of the good. Of those also who, cooperatively, conjointly, and interspersed, have each separately remained in their own places and thought of the sacred beings, with propitiation of Ahura Mazda and scornful notice of the evil spirit, the employment stands forth prominently at the ceremonial. As to the position of others cooperating with him who is an officiating priest of good leadership, there are some who are for the Avesta, there is the solitude by the fire, there are some who are bringers forward of water, there are some who are for carriers away, there are some who are solitary ones, there are some who are gregarious ones, there are some who are directors of duties, and their own needful arrangement in the place is arranged in the ceremony. In cleanliness, purity, and truth, as much as there is in this mingled existence, if one has to commence a ceremony glorifying the sacred beings, when the righteously disposed temperament is purified along with the apparatus, the abundant ritualism of the spirit is a symbol and reminder of the will of the sacred beings, undesired by the fiend, remains a blessing deservedly unto those come together. Then is explained the text of that great scripture which is called the Hadukt, that is itself the best of the chiefs of the scriptures, and of the sublime Dvasda Homast that is not recited by any voice with falsehood, and is called the origin of every truth. The pure glorification of the sacred beings is in the light, this is in the morning time, and even until night the ritualistic and true recitation of revelation is unchangeably proceeding, undivided and faultless. This, too, is in benediction of the angels, this, too, is producing restraint of the fiends, this, too, is in praise of the glorious ones, the mighty doers, this, too, is as an admonition for creatures subject to command, this is in the true words of the ancients who have passed away, this, too, is as a suitable servant for the righteous, these good doers, this, too, is to obtain a permanence of requisites, this, too, is suitable for the discreet and is merciful, this, too, is as another way in which the promoters of good are pardoned, as soon as the Ham juice is digested, through not having eaten from dawn till night during the pure utterance of the pure glorification. And, moreover, one performs no work, nor is even a word uttered, one does not go to sleep, nor should they allow any pollution to the body. The sequence of the religious narangs is, likewise, not changed from that ordered, nor is even a detached thought away from that truth and purity, but always with phrases rightly consecutive and properly worded the Avesta is uttered, and even the manner of response of one's cooperators is in modes contributing to good, or they utter the scripture. Since the production of stench is needing something essentially purifying, many narangs in the ceremonial are tokens and signs which, while they are strongly manifested, are terrifying and vexing to the demons, and inviting and rejoicing to the angels. Such as, indeed, the pure ham, which is squeezed out by four applications of holy water with religious narangs, is noted even as a similitude of the understanding and birth of the four apostles bringing the good religion, who are he who was the blessed Zarathustra and they who are to be Hushadar, Hushadarmah, and Zayashant. As also the metal mortar that is struck during the squeezing of the ham, and its sound is evoked along with the words of the Avesta, which becomes a reminder of the thoughts, words and deeds on the coming of those true apostles into the world. As also the proper rite as regards the water, that they should perform three times, which is showing the world the glorious seizing of water and formation of rain, and the healthfulness of the production of rain. And as the purification of the milk, by the glorious ritualistic product taken from the purifying cattle, is divided in two, by means of which the token is that which is great, glorious, and good, one being for the daughter of Purvahirya the Mazda worshipper, and from her was Ayashnar full of wisdom, and one being Farhank, daughter of Vidhirasa, and from her came Kaikavid. And, as to the high priests of the glorious religion, it is said many concomitants are obtained, such as, much discrimination of scripture, the holy water which is indispensable as a remedy, the healthfulness which is given in that ceremonial to the sacred fire which the world destroys, that preeminent strength which is given at the end of the world from the ox head hayas unto the good people scattered about, it is mingled with the fire of men's bodies, and they, therefore, become perfect and immortal through it, and there are also other things. There are also in the ceremonial many tokens and signs of spiritual mysteries, glorious matters and habitual practices of which statements would be very tedious. And if the wish should be this, that they should be engaged in a single ceremony of the length of a day, a man who is righteous in purification, inside and outside the body, should stay away from all his relations and the worldly transaction of business, from malicious actions and covetous practices, separated from all lying and falsehood of relatives, and his words are to be all those which are serving the angels, glorifying, and begging favors. Then, indeed, the way of the spirit and the harmoniousness of the sacred beings are manifest therefrom, and those which are as much the means due to the primitive good creations as is more purely possible are strengthening as regards the utility for offering, encouraging for purity, confounding for the confusers, terrifying for the fiends, and propitiating for the sacred beings. The ceremonial which is good is when they shall perform it for a pure disposition and assured wisdom, a minder of the religion of the sacred beings of the spheres, and with pure thoughts, just thoughts, wise deeds, a purified body, a tongue worthy of good, a scripture made easy, a true text, ablutions performed, proper rites, undivided, and faultless. Near which fashion, with like abilities, and innumerable times, it is very purely solemnized in the abode of the ever-growing fire, then in the abode of the other sacred fires, then in the abodes of Mazda worshippers and other good people, and then in other places pronounced clean. That of the 3 days is in the abode of the fireplace which is nearest to that of the departed. The ceremony of the guardian spirits of the righteous is solemnized in purity there where the dwelling is which is nearest that of the departed whose soul is honored. And that for victories in war is then at its times of battle. The husbandry of Sam and other offenders who were for keeping away husbandry, the household attendant's place for a warrior of another rank, the occasion of the outcry of those not possessing a lodging, unto the rest of the same temperament, expressly to produce and maintain a proportional resemblance. Chapter 49. As to the 48th question and reply, that which you ask is thus, as to them who shall buy corn and keep it in store until it shall become dear, and shall then sell it at a high price, what is the nature of the decision? The reply is this, that when there is nothing therein on account of which I should so deem it otherwise than due to the eating of the requisite amount of food for oneself, that which is his controlling impulse, and not the teachings of the worthy and good, is the internal instruction which a time of scarcity has taught by means of the occurrences during that time, but clamorous worldly profit is want of diligence, for they would buy to make people distressed, and in order that they may sell again dearer. Moreover, the store one keeps, and keeps as closed even unto the good as unto the bad, and though it be necessary for a man of the good and worthy, and they beg for some of the food, they shall not sell at the price it is worth at that time, on account of its becoming dearer, one keeps in store unauthorizedly and grievously sinfully, and every calamity of those good people they shall suffer who would not sell it at the price they beg. On account of that non-obtainment of corn, or that unlawfully heinous sin, and because of dearness of price it is not proper to give it for that non-distribution unto him himself, or those under his control, or the poor to whom it would be given by him, and the distribution that occurs is then retaliative upon him. And if the corn be spoiled, through keeping too long a time in store, he is suffering assault from the hungry man who is injured even by that damaging of the corn, if through that unlawful want of preservation noxious creatures are associated with the corn, he is overwhelmed also by that heinous sin, and, through the profit of improper diligence he is unworthy. But if it be necessary for their own people who are under their control, on account of the fear of a time of scarcity, they should buy at their own suitable time, and should afford protection. Or, because of the teachings of the good and worthy, they should buy corn at a cheap price from a place where the corn is more than the requirements of the eaters, and they should bring it unto there where corn is scarce, provided the good and those requiring corn are sufficient. So that, while their information of a scarcity of corn is even from him himself to whom the price would become profit, or is the persistence of these same teachings of the good, so that it may become more abundant unto them than unto the bad, even in the time of scarcity when it is very much raised in price, they should buy corn at a cheap price during an excess of corn, so that one may keep it until the time of a period of scarcity. When there occurs a necessity for it among the good, he sells it at such price as one buys it at that time, that is, the market price. By that means, in a season of scarcity, much more is obtained in price, and it becomes more plentiful among the good, then a more invigorating praise of him is commendable. And, yet, as regards that which is suitable profit and also apart from the eating of corn, from anything eatable for the maintenance of life, from medicine and remedies for the healthfulness of life, and from whatever is for the preservation of life, it is allowable that they shall buy and shall sell dear. Chapter 50. The 49th question is that you ask thus, if they should sell wine unto foreigners and infidels, what is then the decision about it? The reply is this, that there is very vehement danger of grievous sin, and it would be an evil occupation. But if through the operation of that wine selling of theirs the wine is kept more away from those who become worse through immoderate drinking of wine, and comes to those who drink wine in moderation, whom they cause to become better through drinking the wine, more than when they shall not practice that selling of the wine, then through that selling of theirs the power which is in the wealth, by their keeping away of which a man is confirmed in the good religion and diverted from going into infidelity, the progress of sin is impeded and good works are promoted, becomes the assistance of the good and protection of religion, the hindrance of sin and aid of good works, which, when they shall not practice that wine selling, do not arise, and which are much more promoted than the various sins that might have arisen from the unlawfully drinking of wine. Or, otherwise, the greater decision, and great are the good works which are assured therein, is thus, they who shall sell wine to foreigners, infidels, and others from whom unlawful conduct arises through drunkenness, act very sinfully and not authorizedly. Chapter 51. The 50th question is that which you ask thus, as to one of the good religion who drinks wine immoderately, and loss and injury happen to him owing to that immoderate drinking, what is then the decision about him? And how is the measure of wine drinking which when they drink is then authorized for them? The reply is this, that whoever through the influence of opportunity drinks wine immoderately, and is adult and intelligent, through every loss and injury which thereupon come to him from that immoderate drinking, or which occasion anything unto anyone, is then his causing such pollution to the creatures, in his own pleasurably varied modes, that the shame owing to it is a help out of that affliction. And even he who gives wine authorizedly unto anyone, and he is thereby intoxicated by it, is equally guilty of every sin which that drunkard commits owing to that drunkenness. And concerning that drunkenness, what is said is that that is to be eaten through which, when one eats it, one thinks better, speaks better, and acts better, and such even is the food by which, through having drunk wine, one becomes more virtuous, or does not become more vicious, in thought, word, and deed. When an experiment as regards its being good is tried, so that having drunk it in that proportion one becomes better, or does not become worse, then it is allowable to drink it. When an untried person, for the sake of being tried, has drunk a mingled portion, first of one drinking cup, secondly of two drinking cups, and thirdly of three drinking cups, and through drinking it he becomes more virtuous, or does not become more vicious, in thought, word, or deed, he is to increase the drinking cups, and the experiment is allowable unto those tested just so far as the proportion is such that he becomes better, or does not become worse. To those tested it is authorizedly given to that amount through which the experimenting that is mentioned has extended, and to him who it is proved will become worse through the drinking of wine, that amount, through the drinking of which, when given in the experiment, it was seen that he became worse, is not authorizedly given. In a case of doubt one is to consider him who is orthodox, who has chanted the sacred hymns, and is of good repute, whose drunkenness is not manifest, in this way, that he drinks as much wine as was tried by him when he became no worse by drinking it. It is necessary to consider him whose religion is unseen, whose religion is wrong, and him who is a child furnished even with the realities of religion, in this way, that he becomes worse through having drunk wine. When apart from the decision there is no assignable reason as regards it, the share of wine which they gave not authorizedly who themselves drank wine, one considers as some of the wine on its being given more authorizedly. Chapter 52. As to the 51st question and reply, that which you ask is thus, there is a man who hands over a dirham as regards 5 bushels of wheat, thus, I give this to thee as an installment of 5 bushels of wheat at the end of a month, and during the month, and at its end, those 5 bushels of wheat become 5 times the price, would they authorizedly seize the 5 bushels of wheat when winnowed by him, through that installment which he handed over, or not? The reply is this, that when they who shall take his dirham have to entrust the 5 bushels of wheat, unsuspiciously and by their own will, to him to winnow, even so as they are advisedly and unsuspiciously winnowed by him they should take them just as winnowed, this is the decision authorizedly given. But when it is winnowed by him on account of very grievous necessity for payment, it is more suitable for the soul to beg the giver of the money, who is the purchasing payer, for some of that excess of undivided profit. For he has to consider the profit of his successors as among the profit of money on the spot, when more than such installment demanded, and not as a fresh carrying off of a gift. Chapter 53. As to the 52nd question and reply, that which you ask is thus, if people of the good religion, in their country or out of their country, shall buy and sell with those of a different religion as regards cattle, or shall lay hold of traders and shall sell to them, what is then the decision about it? When those of the good religion shall not buy, as they have not come up to the price, but the orthodox dealers shall sell to traders and those of a different religion, what is then the decision about it? And about him, of whom the means of existence are such, what is then the decision? The reply, is this, that it would be very grievously sinful, and it would be an evil occupation to transact such business through the influence of opportunity, and to seek profit unauthorizedly, in that manner. But if it be the means of existence of those of the good religion of whom you have written, and they are not able to seek it in any other business and proper occupation which would be a less sinful means of existence, complete purchasers who have acquired the good religion shall sell unto those of the good religion, because it is possible for him to be less sinful to whom it is allowable to beg the life of comrade, for still the rule of a righteous man, with the righteous who are in his guardianship, is to live. So it is possible, when they shall sell cattle for slaughter and foreign eating, many cattle, amounting even to a diminution of the maintenance of Iran, are more wretched than a righteous man forced to kill them through a living becoming unobtainable and the fear of death. Chapter 54. As to the 53rd question and reply, that which you ask is thus, a man whose wife, daughters, sisters, and relations are many, and who is the master of much wealth, becomes sick, and during the sickness has given this hoard of wealth unto one daughter. And his other sisters and daughters are not contented therewith, and speak thus, this wealth ought to have been given during health and consciousness, not during sickness, and now it should not be allowable to give anything whatever unto anyone during sickness, for if anything happens the wealth all comes back for division amongst us. Would it be allowable to give anything whatever of that wealth to anyone, during sickness, or not? Is it necessary for one of such wife, daughters, and sisters as there happen to be to appoint an adopted son for that man, because of that wealth, or not? Are the wife, daughters, and sisters who shall take their share of the wealth responsible for the religious rites of every kind, and is it necessary for them to order the annual ceremonies for that man at the daily and yearly periods, or not? The reply is this, that, when there is nothing therein on account of which I should so deem him otherwise than a man in sickness and nearly passing away, it is not allowable to give it up, except when it is for his debts, or his wife and children, or an aged person or father who is in his guardianship, whom it is indispensably necessary to maintain, and is such as, or as much as, is discreetly requisite for payment of the debt, or for the food, maintenance, and protection of those, that I have written about, then, however, it is allowable to give it up away from those of whom you have written, as much as during his consciousness. In other sickness, not while passing away, whatever is given up by him himself during consciousness is allowable, when he is not conscious it is not allowable. And on that which he says during unconsciousness one is not reliant and it is not credible, but that which he says during consciousness, and that, too, which the same man gave unto a daughter when he was ill, if given by him consciously, are even then proceedings to be granted, if given by him during unconsciousness it is just as though he died without an opportunity of speaking. Of the property left by will, one share is needful for each separate daughter for whom a husband is not provided, and two shares for a wife who may be a privileged one, and so long as the wife is living she exists as the house mistress of the family. Moreover, it is not needful to appoint an adopted son, for the adopted son's duty remains with her, and she manages to claim guardianship for the family from some man out of the relatives most nearly allied. Out of the portion of the property for food and maintenance the wife should provide the daughters with husbands, and to keep going the necessities in the guardianship, the nurture which the deceased man afforded, and the ceremonies and good works imposed upon the family, and thereby become indispensable, she herself is to take lapfuls and armfuls out of the income. As to the sisters of that man, if they have been necessarily in his guardianship, even as to nourishment, and there is no property for them in any other way, their food and maintenance are also needful to be out of the income of the property, unless that man has otherwise devised, or the appointment of a husband is not provided on account of the non-subjection in which they have been unto the guardianship of that man, or anything else opposed to it, so that nothing whatever of the property of that man is needful for them. He who is a husband of one of the daughters is a leader in the management of the family, but with the concurrence of the house mistress of the family, and even so when the action is one which they should not do, and his son is not born, or becomes passing away. As to a daughter not provided with a husband, should the one whose husband is not provided be an only child, to keep her subject also to the house mistress of the family it is needful for her that there should be an adopted son in it. And when they shall appoint her husband unto the adopted sonship the property then comes over into his possession. When the house mistress of the family passes away, and the daughters are provided with husbands, the adopted sonship is to be appointed. Chapter 55. As to the 54th question and reply, that which you ask is thus, what is the occupation and capacity of the person that has to preserve those who are in their three nights trials, and who is he? The reply is this, that it is said a husband is indispensable for preservation through the three nights trials which shall be for a privileged wife, a father for those of a child, and a master for those of a servant.